Fans of Doctor Who during the Wilderness years will know the name Kate Orman quite well. Kate Orman was a writer who grew up watching Jon Pertwee and Tom Baker in Doctor Who in the 1970s, and she became a very prominent writer during the Wilderness years for the Virgin New Adventures, for Bernie Summerfield, for the BBC Books range, frequently collaborating with her husband and also collaborating with writers such as Ben Aronovich, writing multiple Doctors over the Wilderness years period. She has not written a Doctor Who book for approaching 20 years now, but she has actually written now a brand new Doctor Who audio novel for Big Finish, Doctor Who The Dead Star. This is a 6.5-ish hour audio book starring the Second Doctor, Ben and Polly. So this is very early on in the Second Doctor's era, before they've even met Jamie. This is a book that is narrated by Patrick Troughton's son, Michael Troughton, who has been playing the Second Doctor in recent Big Finish box sets as well, so there is the precedent for this as well. And basically the premise of Doctor Who The Dead Star is that you have the Second Doctor and Ben and Polly. They arrive on Earth in the 1960s only for everything to be a little bit topsy-turvy. They land and everything is literally sideways. Let's play a quick clip from near the beginning of Doctor Who The Dead Star.
For a moment, the three space-time travellers stared out at the world outside, bewildered. Then Polly said, "You've landed sideways. The TARDIS must be lying on the pavement." The Doctor frowned. It was as though the walls were the ground, and the ground was a wall. Everything was turned sideways.
"It's not us that's sideways," said Ben. "It's the world."
"Stay here, both of you." The Doctor got down on his hands and knees and crawled through the doorway, out into the sidelong world. He crept along the front of one building, then the next, as though he was an enormous black beetle.
"Look at the shops, Polly," said Ben. "Isn't this Carnaby Street?"
He trailed off uncertainly.
"Where are the cars? Or the people? And why is everything..."
Polly waved a hand at the confusing view.
"Topsy-turvy."
The Doctor reached the shut door of the next shop along and stopped.
"Ha-ha! Watch this!"
And he stood up. Polly and Ben both gasped. Somehow it seemed like a dangerous thing to do, as though the Doctor would topple onto the paving stones. But he stood there, at a 90-degree angle to the road, grinning. "This new Doctor is familiar and strange at the same time," thought Polly. "A bit like this sideways street."
"You can come out now," the Doctor called. "Don't worry about the windows. They won't break."
I do like how Michael Troughton does try and give Ben like a little bit of Cockney, but he really does a great job at embodying his father, Patrick Troughton. It is just a great impression. You can absolutely hear the intonations, the cadence, everything from the Second Doctor. It's just wonderful to hear. But so the story follows the Doctor, Ben and Polly. They go to this 1960s London where everything is a bit sideways, where there are like different pocket dimensions which are literally popping and bursting, and they have to try and escape through those. It's a really great and atmospheric way to open The Dead Star, where you kind of got vibes of Dead London from War of the Worlds, where these empty city streets where you've kind of been away for an extended period of time. You come back and everything has gone absolutely wrong and you have no idea what's happening. Now, fast forward to a little bit later, where they find themselves back on Earth. They escape those dimensions, where they find that the Earth has about 1 month left to live, because a black hole is making its way through a time corridor and is going to destroy the Earth. And it's making its way across the solar system. It engulfs Mars. It engulfs the Moon. And there's very little that the Doctor, Ben and Polly can do to stop it. They get embroiled in this organization which are trying to predict cataclysmic events and make sure that the general public don't know anything about it. There's some really cool sci-fi tech where you put a cream on and it either makes you super intelligent, or it makes you a much better fighter, or it gives you some scientific know-how. There's some really, really cool set pieces over the course of the Dead Star audio story. Like I said, it's about 6.5 hours long, narrated by Michael Troughton. And I think in terms of the characterization, it gets like the Second Doctor and Ben and Polly really, really well. The supporting cast, I honestly found them to be, you know, they were fine and interesting, but it was the world building that made everything so interesting. The way that when the Doctor, Ben and Polly go to try and go to the other end of this time corridor to try and stop these black holes from engulfing Earth, the technology that's on this spaceship, and also the way that the black holes sort of manifest themselves. Like there's multiple of them that are making their way across space like speeding bullets. There's a terrific set piece later on where the second Doctor, Ben and Polly, are in a room, and there's a black hole in the room with them about the size of an atom, and it has the gravitational pull of an asteroid. So not that much of a gravitational pull, but you can sort of feel the presence in the room, and they have to try and avoid it, because if it goes through them or they walk through it, it will tear a hole in them and rip them apart like an invisible bullet. And there's some really grim sci-fi deaths, like Event Horizon style existential dread, that I'm kind of amazed that, like, this wouldn't be able to be put on TV without some sort of disclaimer at the beginning of it. It was so, like, the way that you're able to get the characters' internal monologues as they meet these really brutal fates because of these black holes is really quite disarming. I wasn't really expecting it going into this audio story, but it's stuff like that, the set pieces, that really set the Dead Star apart. There's a really great set piece where Ben and Polly are spacewalking, and they've got the gel on them, so they know all the science fiction trappings, and they sort of know how to use the spacesuit technology. But midway through the spacewalk, the gel starts wearing off, and she has to put her faith in the Doctor who's talking to her in her helmet. Polly has to put her faith in the second Doctor. And there's some really, really great moments like that. I think the fact that it's able to go from memorable set piece to memorable set piece is really what sets the Dead Star apart and makes it memorable. I think the characterization is fine, but it's the world building, it's the set pieces that made this a really engrossing listen. And the fact that we're dealing with not necessarily a proper tangible threat or some sort of eccentric antagonist, although there are a couple of those over the course of the story, the actual big bad is the concept of these black holes making their way down the time tunnel and engulfing Earth in this massive apocalyptic event. And I'm going to play you another clip from The Dead Star, which sort of hits home this almost like Lovecraftian idea of these sort of massive cosmic forces that will try and whisk you away and destroy your world, and there's nothing you can do about it. And it's a really, really effective set piece. I'm going to play the clip.
The road was full of people running and screaming, horns blaring as cars tried to force their way through. The penny had finally dropped. London was panicking. Polly gasped, "What is it? What's happening?" The Doctor jumped out of the limo, shading his eyes as he looked upwards, following the gaze of the terrified crowd. His expression was grim. He said nothing, so Ben and Polly got out as well to see what he was looking at. The moon was falling apart. It was a fat, pale disc in the blue summer sky, hovering just above the buildings. There were great cracks visible in its full face, and pieces which must be bigger than mountain ranges were floating away from it. Polly thought of those American astronauts. They wouldn't be visiting that anytime soon. Trying to imagine the black hole, she had visualized a huge black maw, like the mouth of a panther. But Ben had said it was less than a foot wide, hadn't he? It was less than a marauding predator, and more like a virus or a drop of poison, invisible and fatal. She asked, "How long have we got, Doctor?" The mini robot said,
17 minutes 40 seconds on my mark.
"Come on," said the Doctor, getting back into the car.
Just the idea of like total societal collapse because Mars gets destroyed, and then a day later the moon, you can see it in the sky getting ripped apart by a black hole that's like 10 inches across. It kind of puts into perspective the scariness of the universe, and the Dead Star was absolutely able to get across those themes. Now, I don't think this is like a 100% must listen, although I do think that as somebody, like I'm somebody who's not a massive fan of Ben and Polly as being like TARDIS companions. I just didn't find them that interesting in the TV series. But I think Kate Orman's like inner monologue and description of their thoughts and their characterization in The Dead Star generally is really, really good. They're really good companions in this serial. But I do think that she gets the Second Doctor's characterization like down to a T. She's never written for the Second Doctor before, to my knowledge, but she like instantly from scene one absolutely captures his eccentricities and his mannerisms. And then Michael Troughton just brings them to life. The Dead Star is a really good audiobook. It is short, comparatively speaking, to like other big audiobooks. I don't know if it's like the best value for money or anything. It's $17.99 for a narrated audiobook, but you've got your music, you've got sound effects, and you've got great narration by Michael Troughton. If you're somebody who loved Kate Orman's work in the 1990s during the Wilderness Years, I don't need to tell you anything. You've already pre-ordered it. You've probably already listened to it at this point. But for those who are like big Second Doctor fans or like big cosmic dread, or what really carries you through a Doctor Who story is not necessarily the characters or the characterization, it's the world building and or the set pieces, then I think that The Dead Star is a safe recommendation. I don't think it's a must listen, but if those are the things you go into Doctor Who really wanting to get something out of, if these are the things in fiction that you really gravitate towards, then I recommend The Dead Star. This is the first Doctor Who audio novel from Big Finish that I've listened to. This is the fourth one now in terms of this like current range. You've got Scourge of the Cybermen, Watchers, Emancipation of the Daleks, and now The Dead Star. Because I got a review copy from Big Finish, this is the first one that I've actually listened to. And it was a good first one. I think that, like I said, Michael Troughton is sort of the glue holding this together because he is just such a great impressionist of his late father. I think that that really is the nice icing on the cake, but I think Kate Orman's world building and how she's able to seamlessly hop from death-defying set piece to death-defying set piece without making it feel exhausting is a real testament to her ability as a writer, and I think she's done a great job here, and I look forward to seeing what she does next. I think that it should not be another 20 years before she graces the Doctor Who universe again.